So good afternoon, and it's really great to be back in Finland again. My name is Alan Smith. I've visited here a few times, presented at Tech Days a few years ago, presented at other events as well. I always love coming over. It's a quick flight from Stockholm, where I'm based, and it's always had a good crowd and good events here. So the session I'm going to be delivering is talking about Azure Service Fabric Reliable Actors. I'm going to be talking about some demos, some scenarios, showing you some code, and talking about future projects that I'm going to be working on. So a bit about me. My name is Alan Smith. I'm from the north of England. I moved to Sweden in 1998, moved to Stockholm. And I work for a company called Active Solution. We're a consultancy company, but building .NET applications. And what we've noticed in the past 12 months is, past 24 months, but especially in the past 12 months, is we've gone from building .NET applications to building .NET applications on the Azure platform. Many, many of our customers have evolved in Azure projects. And I would describe myself now as being a full-time Azure developer. I wouldn't have said that 2 years ago. I was learning about Azure, but now I work as a full-time Azure developer. My contract says I'm a senior consultant, but that makes me feel old, so I describe myself as a developer, trainer, mentor, and evangelist. I love developing, writing code. I love working in Visual Studio, building proof of concepts, building prototype projects, working on production code, and building hobby projects. I also work as a trainer. I do courses for Pluralsight, deliver training courses in BizTalk Server and in Microsoft Azure. And I've been in Helsinki years and years ago, teaching an advanced BizTalk course as well. I'm also an Azure MVP, like many of the speakers here, and I pretty much know all of the speakers from the MVP Summit and from other events. And I also work as a community leader. So I'm involved in the CloudBirds conference in Stockholm, which some of you have visited. I know we've had people coming over from Finland. And also I'm involved with the Global Azure Bootcamp, working with some of the actual hands-on labs that people are going to be doing during the day. I'm also a bit of a telemetry geek, or I've become a telemetry geek, working with telemetry and messages. And I also always like working on the back end of things, working with back end programming and so on. As I mentioned, I'm a Pluralsight author, so I've got a couple of courses. What I choose to do is pick one technology and focus in a lot of depth on that technology. So I've done a storage in depth course, which is almost 7 hours looking at Azure storage. Pluralsight complained and said they didn't want it to be that long, but I really wanted to put in the appropriate amount of depth. And I've done the same thing with the service bus. And I'm currently working on stream analytics, hopefully get that out in a few weeks. So what we're going to talk about today is we're going to start off talking about the actor model, a bit of theory on the actor model, and then look in some of the technologies that you can use for working with the actor model on the Microsoft platform. We'll then start to look at the Azure Service Fabric offerings and how they implement the actor model. Look at a scenario and demo of an implementation, and then look at how I'm planning on using the actor model for the driving game during the Global Azure Bootcamp, which is coming up in the next few months. So the actor model, basically devised in the 70s, like a lot of the computer theory, basically mostly theoretical, and they didn't have sort of these big, large multi-server environments. But Carl Hewitt, who's one of sort of the main proponents of the actor model, came up with this model and described it as being a mathematical model about concurrent computation. We've got object-orientated programming where everything has got a class, everything is an object, and we treat everything as an actor. And actors have certain limitations and certain things that you can do with actors. Also, if you listen to this video, I'll give you a link to the video from the lang.next conference in 2012. It's inspired by Einstein's theory of relativity and quantum computing. I don't really get where they're going with this, but they go into these big theoretical discussions about quantum physics and how the actor model relates to that. Motivated by the prospect of highly parallel computing. This is something that really blows my mind, because they were doing this in 1973, and it's now, 30-something years later, when we're actually getting to, or 40-something years later, my math isn't that great, where we're actually starting to do this and implement this in, highly parallel environments that we've got in cloud computing. So it's great that that theory was going on, way ahead of its time. So the actor model basically describes three things that an actor can do when it can receive a message. One of the things that it can do is it can create new actors. So an actor can receive a message and it can create new actors. So if it's an online game, a player can basically create a game actor when they start playing a game, and it can create multiple game actors. The game can then start creating actors for, shooting things, blowing things up, getting certain achievements and so on. And we treat everything as an actor when we're modeling this. Actors can also send messages to other actors. Every actor has an inbox or a mailbox or some kind of way of being able to interact or send messages to it. And the messages are sent asynchronously to these other actors. Actors can also, when they receive a message, decide what to do when the next message is received. So we can put some programming logic inside those actors so that when the next message is received, we're going to take this particular action. And that's it. That's what we can do with the actor model. Scenarios that people are using the actor models for in cloud computing, one of them is online gaming, and I'll talk a bit about how Orleans was used in Halo to provide the implementation of the actor model there. That was one of the first big cloud-based actor model implementations that Microsoft did. Also, something that's gaining a lot of ground now is IoT and telemetry, the Internet of Things. Both of these scenarios, gaming and telemetry, they both involve massive scale. They involve lots of players or lots of users, and they both generate telemetry streams. So when you're playing Halo, or if you're driving your car, or you've got, say, a wind farm somewhere, it's generating a stream of telemetry data. And the actor model is a very scalable way of being able to analyze and process those data streams. And we'll look at that later on in the demo. So online gaming, Halo 4 and Halo 5, basically Microsoft had a technology in Microsoft Research, which was called Microsoft Orleans, and the Halo team went to the Orleans team and says, okay, we need to have a back-end for Halo that goes beyond what Xbox Live does. We want to have something called Halo Waypoint. We want to track all of the interactions as people are playing Halo. And they're going into production now. I think Halo 5, I just got updated this slide after speaking to Dan Rossanova, doing about 1.2 million messages per second at peak load. The Orleans platform was scaling about to 125 servers, dynamically scaling as well. And they're building up game stats for all of the online players and publishing that data out to Halo Waypoint. So you can go in on a Windows phone application and see how your friends are doing and see how you're doing in the various Halo games. As I mentioned, IoT, this is becoming a big business now, internet connected everything. And you think about cars and maps and so on, all of this mapping software, automatic driving cars, a lot of this is using telemetry data from vehicles. Think about how a taxi company or a delivery company can benefit from having very detailed telemetry information coming in real time from their vehicles and be able to provide real time updates. We also, when we're dealing with an actor model, want to think about reliability. Having everything in memory isn't a great option, so we want to ensure that we've got persistence. So a couple of concepts that are going to be introduced is reliable actors. Reliable actor means that the actor state is persisted in durable storage. The storage that we've got in the cloud-based services writes to multiple bits of physical media. So when you store, it's going to be stored on, you know, three physical hard drives if you sort of dig down into the infrastructure. The machines that we use in Azure are very temporary. We've got, you know, as I mentioned, 125 servers in the Halo platform. These servers are failing all of the time. The failure rate is about 2 or 3% of servers. So servers are failing all of the time. But we don't want to lose data if the servers fail. So instead of keeping stuff in memory, we ensure that active state is persisted to some kind of a durable storage. Virtual actors is another concept, meaning that actors are activated on demand, and they can be persisted and they can be unloaded from memory and remain present in the actual storage. This is important when you think about how people play Halo. There may be millions and millions of people who play an online game, but they don't play it all of the time. So you don't want to keep all of these this data in memory. You want a way that when somebody is playing, their data, their actor is going to be in memory. When they stop playing, it will be left in storage and unloaded from memory. And when they start playing again a few days later, it's loaded back into a memory, and they continue from where they let off. So we have a lot of this activation and deactivation of these actors and also persistence into storage systems. So we basically have a state storage, and this is an example of a fitness actor that's maybe tracking me running. So I basically register with the actor service. And registering for the first time, if I don't have an actor present, is going to create an actor for me. So the Alan actor is created. All actors will have IDs. I'm just using my first name there. It'll normally be a GUID or some kind of identifier for the actor, player ID or, you know, Xbox Live ID or so on. Then I'm going to start sending messages to the actor. I'm going to start running. So the actor, when I start running, basically is tracking the distance that I've run. And I've run 0 meters, so of 0 kilometers. I run 2 kilometers, and it stores that state in memory. But it's also got the state persisted in the state storage in case the actual actor service that's hosting this in memory fails. And these are on different machines, different storage services and so on. I keep on running, I send a message 3, and it's basically keeping a total of how far I've run. So now the actual state is 5. I then take a break for 30 minutes, and it detects I'm no longer actively running, so it's removed the active from memory. But I've still got that state in the storage, and when I start running again, it basically continues tracking the actual data there. One of the challenges with the actor model is retrieving the state and understanding whereabouts the state is. As .NET developers, we're so used to having SQL Server as our back end. Everything is stored in the big old SQL database, and we go in and do select star from the runners where the name is equal to Alan, and we get back the actual distance that Alan has run. But there is no big old SQL database. There's no table that's storing the state of all of these actors, unless we explicitly create one for monitoring purposes. So all of the state is stored in the state storage system. So we have challenges in that there's a different way of accessing this data, a different way of accessing statistics. How do we do reports and figure out what the actual total is? You could do select star from the big old database, or select the sum of distance from the big old database, or the average of distance from the big old database. It might be challenging to do that if you've got the actor in a state storage system. Anybody here worked with BizTalk? BizTalk orchestrations remind. There's a lot of hands going up. A lot of people have done BizTalk. That's surprising. The stuff that we did with orchestrations in BizTalk is quite similar to the actor model when you think about it. Messages come in, and when a message goes into the message box, an orchestration subscribed, you create an instance of that orchestration. And that orchestration is present in memory. And we all know, if you've done lots of stuff with BizTalk orchestrations, that orchestrations can dehydrate and they can unload from memory. So BizTalk developers, if you've worked a lot with orchestrations, if you understand the BizTalk orchestration engine, it's good to go over into the actor model, because there's so many familiar concepts there. So how are we going to start working and start playing around and building things using the actor model? There's currently really three options that we've got on the .NET platform. First one, Microsoft Orleans. This was developed by Microsoft Research. There's a few sessions by a guy called Sergey Biakov, who worked for Microsoft Research, where he talks about how the Orleans model was used in Halo. I'd really recommend watching those sessions for an understanding of how the actor model is used in a large project. The architecture is very good. Orleans has now actually been passed off from Microsoft Research. It's an open source project. It's owned by, I can't remember the name of the company, but it's the company that is sort of owned by Microsoft, but they develop Halo, and it's really owned by the Halo team now, but it is an open source project. So I kind of wouldn't recommend learning Orleans. It's not really used. It was a few years ago before the Service Fabric actor model came along, the weapon of choice if you wanted to do the actor model on Azure. But now we've got the Service Fabric actor model, that's probably a better way to go through. But Orleans is good, I think, as a case study for gaining a bit of an understanding of how the actor model works. We've got Akka.net. Akka.net is available on the .NET platform. You can go in and download it. Again, it's open source. It is an actual port of Akka directly from, I think, Java across to .NET, pretty much a line-for-line port. And it's available for you to be able to actually build models, play around with the actor model. I'll talk about the advantages of Akka.net a bit later on. Then we've got the Service Fabric Reliable Actors, which I'm doing the demos based on today. Notice that the taglines are all very similar. They're all for building distributed applications with certain, bits of things on, they're basically focused on building distributed applications. But if we look at the taglines as well, Orleans is straightforward and high scale, Akka is .NET and simple, and then Service Fabric is always on and scalable. So they have different tendencies, and I'll talk about those as I go through this session. So really the actual facts, I've mentioned that the Orleans is open source, used by Halo, and it's owned by 343 Industries, the company that's working with Halo. It is an open source, but they're sort of responsible for maintaining it. Then we've got Akka and the Service Fabric. Service Fabric is not open source, and it's built for specializing and developing applications on the Azure platform. So use of Halo, I've mentioned that it was used in, so Orleans was used in the Halo project to provide the stats that we get on Halo Waypoint. One of the interesting things, this is why I recommend watching Sergio's presentation, is the challenges that they had when they were building the Halo project on Orleans. If you look at the typical load curves that you get on applications, this is an old slide, but it kind of shows load curves. One-off events like the Olympics, and then we've got predictable events like the Formula One. I don't mean the racing's predictable, but the actual load on the website is predictable, because we know when all of the Grand Prix are going to take place. We know that when the first Grand Prix of the season takes place, there's going to be a big interest, so they are very easy to predict their growth. You've got scalable growth like Twitter, and then you've got unpredictable growth like BBC, unpredictable bursts. So there could be a catastrophe occurring sometime somewhere in the world at this moment. In 2 or 3 minutes, the news services are going to be swamped by people going on and browsing to the news sites, and that could happen at any time. They need to be able to respond to that. With games, this is the load curves that they have to deal with. When the game is launched, they have launch week when many, many people are playing the game, and that's the most popular time when the service is present. After that, the actual load on the services will decrease. Two challenges here. The first one is that you have to provision your environments for a massive peak, and then you have to scale down. In normal cases, we deploy something, we buy a few servers, and if the application becomes popular, we buy more servers, and we buy more servers, and we scale up, and we scale out, and make things bigger and more powerful. Here, we have to reduce the capacity, reduce the costs on running this. So it's a kind of a, you know, deploy big and scale down. That's very suited to cloud computing. Also, you have to get this right. If IT systems break down, users get a bit annoyed. If a game, online game breaks down, users get furious. They start spouting profanities and go on YouTube and start screaming and shouting and swearing. And it's not good for the actual game. A lot of bad publicity if they don't get things right on launch week. So one of the good scenarios about looking at the Orleans project is how they coped with that. I think Sergio was saying they came to him about 3 months before they were going live and says, you know, we're planning to do this with so many million users on day one. Can you build this in 3 months? And he goes through the story of how they actually built and tested and got that scenario working. So the Orleans architecture, if you're looking at Orleans, they don't talk about actors, really. They talk about grains and silos, but basically a grain is an actor. It implements the actor model, and they have their persistent storage and so on. And they were having scenarios. We've got your game heartbeat service going into Event Hub. That's generating the game actors, and they're generating additional actors for the players, and the players are generating additional actors for other things. And this was running at a million messages a second on peak load. Akka.net. This, I think, in my opinion, is the most pure form of the actor model. So if you want to learn programming with the actor model from a theoretical perspective, Akka.net is probably the place to start. It's open source. You can download it. You can install it as a NuGet package. And you can start, I think the sample project is like a Windows Presentation Foundation application that's using actors in the background. So you're writing code in Visual Studio, hitting F5, hitting breakpoints, and basically seeing the stuff run. Very, very quick to get up and running with. Also, the implementation of the actors is a lot more purely focused on the actor model than the Service Fabric technology, as we'll look at the code for the service Fabric there. The disadvantage with Akka.net is when it comes to hosting. If you want to do reliable actors, if you want to have persistence, when I checked a few months ago, the persistence service wasn't 100% operational. So we need to have a good persistence service. How is persistence going to work? Are you going to persist to Azure Storage or to a SQL database? So there isn't really a runtime environment or a cloud-based service where we can actually go in and create a hosting environment to for the Akka model and be able to actually deploy it. So for large-scale applications where you need that cloud-based backend, you need the actual service, you need the reliability, you need the persistence, then that's where you're going to find some limitations with the Akka.net model. So, on to the Service Fabric actor model. This is basically introduction to Service Fabric. Service Fabric is a distributed systems platform that makes it easy to package, deploy, and manage scalable and reliable microservices. So when Microsoft develops technologies, they basically build their cloud-based services, and the Service Fabric has been there for a long time. The project has been going for about 8 years, as long as Azure has been going. And for most of that time, this technology has been hidden. It's something that Microsoft has developed internally. So when they build things like the service bus and storage and all of these other cloud-based services, they're leveraging the technology that's evolved, which is known as Service Fabric. We don't talk about it now, but years and years ago, we used to talk about the Fabric Controller and how the Fabric Controller is responsible for, you know, spinning up instances and running the Azure infrastructure. So basically, Service Fabric is sort of tied in. It's a lower-level service that we've previously had in Microsoft Azure that's been basically closed off for Microsoft to build and develop stuff. So what they've done now is they're making this technology available for us to be able to build our own cloud-based services. So if you want to, build your own cloud-based services, you can go in and you can start using the Service Fabric to actually create these services. We'll talk about when and why you may want to do that a bit later on. But generally, when you're building applications, you're looking at, how are we going to use technology? There's so many Azure services out there. You've got the service bus, you've got storage, you've got various queuing technologies at event hubs. If you can build your applications using those technologies, using those PaaS services, that's probably the best way to go. If you want to create a service using more advanced technologies, your own service that's going to give and leverage more functionality, then you could do that. But what you don't want to do is to start, reinventing the wheel, start building something that's already present in Azure on the Service Fabric. There is quite a high learning curve on it. It will take you a long time to learn about Service Fabric, and it may not be the best option to go for. But for some companies, for some scenarios, it will be a good option for developing applications. So with the Service Fabric, when you're actually building stuff, you're going to go through various phases. You basically download and install the SDK, and the first thing you're going to be doing is developing and testing the application. So you spin up a new project in Visual Studio, and you can start debugging that and running that locally. You're then going to be packaging that and deploying that to the cloud, and then actually monitoring the application in production. For developing and testing it, when you've got the Service Fabric SDK installed, you go in and do File New Project, and you get this new project section in there, the cloud-based templates. There's a lot of talk today about microservices and developing microservice architecture, and we've got these two projects, the stateless service and the stateful service. Stateless service is where it says it's a service that basically isn't going to store state, isn't going to persist state. Stateful service basically is going to have some state which is stored in the service instances, and that state is going to be stored durably, it's going to be persisted. We've got classes like reliable collections, reliable dictionaries that will have some backend storage in there. So that state is going to be stored durably, and it's also going to be server agnostic. So when you start hitting the servers that are running the code, it won't matter which server you hit because they're getting the state from the common data store and processing those. We've also got web API services, guest executables, and also the actor service, which I'm going to be focusing on. When you create one of those new projects, it will basically spin up several projects with deployment scripts, with various bits and pieces, and we'll talk through the project when I get to the actual demonstration. This is the Service Fabric Explorer. So when we're actually going in and testing and diagnosing and debugging it, this is the portal that we're going to be using. When you've got this installed locally, you can right-click and basically browse the Explorer. And this will basically show the environment and the health of the environment. You can get all sorts of reportings and debugging and tracing information from there. You can see the cluster that I'm connected to is localhost. Basically, if you've been programming Azure for a long time, you remember the Azure emulator. First thing you did was you basically installed the Azure SDK, and then you basically built your web role and you built your worker role, and you had your queue sending the messages in between, and you'd spin it up in the Azure emulator, and it will basically emulate the environment. The emulator was a simulation of the actual code that was running in production. So there's all kinds of things, especially with the storage emulator, that worked in the storage emulator but maybe didn't work in production. Here, the actual code that is hosting the environments that you're working with is the actual code that is running in production. So it's a much more faithful way of being able to actually emulate the applications on-premise. This is where one of the problems starts when you're actually working with the Service Fabric. This is not lightweight. So you press F5, and it has to create the local cluster. By default, there's going to be 5 nodes on that local cluster. So it can take maybe 1 or 2 minutes for the actual local cluster to spin up and initialize itself. It can also consume about 10 gigabytes on your hard drive of actual space to actually store all of the state and all of the stuff for the actual services there. So you do need quite a bit of quite a powerful PC, quite a lot of hard drive space, and it's quite heavy. So that's why I was recommending Akka.net when you were going in and just doing a pure actor service model. Write a few lines of code, hit F5, and that code runs, and you can breakpoint. Here, you write a few lines of code, hit F5, and wait for the environment to spin up, and then you can go in and start debugging stuff and so on. So it's a bit more heavy to actually do the turnaround because we have to simulate that full environment on premise. And this is basically as you go in the cluster map. You can see that we've got these 5 instances present, and it's showing information about those instances, how they're running, and so on. And this is kind of mimicking the environment that you will have in production. So second thing that you may find negative when you're going into these actual projects is the actual cost, the cost of actually hosting these environments. So you're talking about an environment where you're having, you know, five instances of virtual machines running to actually host an application that you're deploying there. You know, is that going to be within the actual budget of your application? It's not like a web API service. If you're building microservices, you know, you can spin up a small web API services, a web app, and, you know, on the basic level, it's not going to cost you much to do that. With this, it's going to be a lot more investment in the monthly cost to actually have that environment up and running. So onto the Service Fabric actor model. We've got the Service Fabric runtime. This is like providing the actual foundation of what's going to be running in Service Fabric. And we're going to look at sort of two different scenarios. We're going to look at building microservices using the services and also building an actor model. This is where things differ in that to store the state of the durable services, we have a service context, which handles the reliable connections, and we have our own state provider now, which we're going to be using if we're working with the actor model. If we're building a stateful service, we go through the reliable state manager to store all of the state. With the actor service, we have the actor runtime, and because we're dealing with asynchronous messaging, we have the remote listener and the state provider interfaces there. And on top of that stateful service, you create your own service there with its listening points and various service methods and so on. With the actor service, you're generating your own actors, generating methods of those actors, and then working with the actual communication there. The partitioning, the way this works when you actually deployed it to production, you have various nodes. I've shown three nodes there. You can actually choose a number of nodes there. This is three nodes instead of five. And within the nodes, you will get a number of partitions. And this is all handled within the runtime, so that the actors will be, you know, built and partitioned across these various nodes as well. We also want to have some reliability in there as well. So if a node fails or if a partition fails, we've got the actors failing over. Different ways of handling that state. And I'll show you how that can work when we look at the actual options in the code. So onto actually writing code and building the reliable actors there. What I've created is a class which is called a runner, because I'm going to be working with telemetry data that I've got from an app that's running on my mobile phone, and basically tracking telemetry data as I run to work or as I cycle to work and so on. So we've got these various methods that we're going to be implementing in the actor. I want to be able to get the distance of, you know, how far I've run, and I also want my actor to be able to process a telemetry event. I send it a telemetry event, and it's going to update its actual internal state with the actual telemetry data that's coming in. So I'm going to be sending it a stream of telemetry data. It's going to be keeping that state, and then I want to be able to get the distance and, you know, figure out how far I've run. The actors, once you've created an actor, needs to be registered with the actor runtime. So here I've basically got the runner actor. I'm calling register actor async and specifying that I'm going to be passing in the runner and generating a new instance of that runner. And all of the actors that we're working with, so if you're working with a game and you've got players and you've got enemies and you've got games and you've got, you know, guns and weapons and so on, all of those actions that are going to take place in the game are going to be implemented as actors there that you're going to have to actually register with the actor runtime. And that will initialize the actor in the runtime and allow you to be able to actually work with that actor. The way that we communicate with an actor is through an actor proxy. I was mentioning that the ACCA framework provides a more sort of true and faithful implementation of the actor model. I mentioned earlier in the slides also that the actors have mailboxes. When you're dealing with the ACCA model, you deal with messages and mailboxes and so on the actual actors themselves. When you go over to the Service Fabric actor model, instead of dealing with the messages and mailboxes, we're dealing with these proxies, and the proxies are based on interfaces. So this is more sort of closer to object orientated and not sort of really, you know, using messages, mailboxes and so on as the true actor model will do. We've still got the same principles in that we're working with messages. It's just, you know, slightly different from the way things work in ACCA. Every actor is going to have an ID, and you've got the choice when you generate an actor of supplying your own ID or having the actor generate its own ID based on a GUID and so on. So I basically generate this instance of the class, which is an actor ID. I can generate one, or I can pass in a string or pass in a GUID or so on. And I'm using the actual ID of the runner that's coming from the telemetry application to generate that actor. So I basically get the ID, which is an actor ID. I then call actorproxy.create and specify the actual actor that I want created, which is iRunner, and also specify the ID. If that actor does not exist, it will be created within the actor runtime when I call that line of code. If that actor does exist and it's in memory, I'll get a proxy to it in memory. If it does exist in durable storage but not in memory, it will be loaded into memory and I'll get an actual proxy to that actor in memory. I can then call a process telemetry event, which is one of the methods I implement on that interface, and send in the telemetry data, and the actor will process that. The actor classes themselves are all basically going to look like this. We provide it as an internal class. It's not going to be accessed outside of the class library. And we specify that we derive this class from actor, from the actor base class, which is part of the service fabric, and it implements the iRunner interface, which will give us the actual methods. One important thing that we're specifying in the attribute is state persistence. And I'm specifying state persistence is persisted, which means I get the durable storage. Three options here. And they affect the reliability and also the performance of your application. So persisted, this is the most reliable option. The state is going to be written to disk and replicated in memory. So if we whiz a few slides back when I was talking about this slide here, replicated in memory means that you will get more than one copy of each actor across the actual cluster. And this is why we want to have more than one node. So if node 2 fails, there will be a copy of node 2's actors on node 3 and on node 1, and we won't lose the actual in-memory state of the actors, even though we're not persisting to a durable state storage. So that's kind of a middle way, volatile. Basically means we're keeping it in memory and it's not replicated. So if one of the nodes fails, we're still gonna maintain the state of the actors. However, if we get a catastrophic failure and lots of the nodes fail, then we may lose the state of the actors. You know, is that a big issue? For people, say, playing Candy Crush Saga, is that going to be a really big issue there? Having a volatile state will allow us to process a lot more messages per second because we're not actually going down to the durable storage, but we're compromising the reliability for performance. Then you've got none, which will give you very, very high performance and also consume less resources because we're only keeping one copy of the actual state in memory. We're not doing any replication, but you've got to remember this 2 to 3% failure rate, that there is 2 or 3% chance per year that a node will fail and you'll lose the state of all actors. If you can live with that and you need the performance, then you could probably go for that none option. So I'm going to look at the implementation that I've built and how I'm sort of the decisions that I made, design decisions I made when I was building that demonstration. So I cycle to work, sometimes run to work, and also sort of walk around taking my kids to daycare and so on. And I've become a bit obsessed with telemetry, and I've got this sport tracker application on my mobile phone. So every time I leave the house, I start this thing going, and it basically tracks the actual telemetry data as I'm traveling around and going to work and going around and so on. So I kind of count the calories, count the kilometers and so on. So as I was working with this, the actual website allows you to go in and view the telemetry data and also download the telemetry data in XML format. So you can actually see the bits of telemetry and be able to actually analyze and understand what's happening with that telemetry data. So here is what the telemetry data looks like. It's basically based on these track points. We start off with sort of the outer XML, and as we go in, basically it depends on the performance of your phone, but basically about once a second or a couple of times a second, we're going to be storing one of these track points. You can see the track point contains the actual position of where I am at this particular point in the world. So I'm at 59.34 latitude, 17.98 longitude, which is probably close to my house in Stockholm. Elevation of 10.8 meters. And we've also got the actual time, UTC time, when that actual snapshot was taken. So this was taken on the 7th of September, 0557. And this is UTC, so it's probably about 7:57, 3 minutes to eight. So I'm probably a bit late taking my kids to school on that particular day. But that's basically one bit of telemetry data. So this one's coming at 0557.41. This one comes in at 0557.43. So this is a couple of seconds later. And you can see that there's a slight difference in the latitude. There's a slight difference in the longitude as well. So this is a different position that we've come in. Now, what we're interested in many telemetry scenarios is taking a stream of telemetry data If you think about Internet of Things and you think about these apps, especially IoT technologies, they don't want to run lots of computation on the actual device. The device has to be simple. So the telemetry messages that it's going to be sending into Event Hub are going to be simple. They're not going to contain lots and lots of information. However, when we want to analyze that telemetry information, we want to have it enriched. Having just a stream of position and elevation and time doesn't really say how people are running or how cars are driving or what the actual situation of the traffic is in downtown Helsinki. So what we need to do is to start doing calculations. We get these two bits of telemetry data in. The first thing we're going to do is say, okay, well, how far apart are these two telemetry points based on their latitude and longitude? And we get the total distance that we can actually keep in the actual state of the actor. So each telemetry reading comes in, we'll get the actual distance, and I can add that up and get the total distance that I've traveled. We then can take the actual time difference between these two and add that, and that will give us the total time. We can then start doing calculations, like the speed is going to be the distance divided by the time, and that's the speed just for those particular two telemetry readings. So that's the instantaneous speed at which I was traveling over those past 2 seconds. We can also get the average speed for the entire run, which is going to be the total distance divided by the total time, and build up those types of statistics. So that's the kind of enrichment that we're doing. So what we need to do is to look at the those two points, where they are in the world, and then do an actual calculation. And this is the code that I... you always do this when you're writing code. If you don't know how to do something, you Google for it, and that basically gives you a link to Stack Overflow, and then you copy-paste that code into the actual solution, and pretty much it works. So this is basically using latitude and longitude to figure out the actual distance. You need the Earth's radius in there as well to do that calculation there. So this is how I've built the environment and done my implementation on the service fabric. I've got my sports actor, and what I'm showing here is the actual state that I'm storing in this. And this is going to be the state that's persisted into the reliable storage. I've got the total distance, I've got the actual start time, and I store the actual last event that was actually received. The total distance and start time is basically all I need for being able to calculate the average time, because I don't need to store the average time, I can just calculate that from those two values. When the next telemetry event comes in, I need to have the last telemetry event, because I need to be able to do that comparison. So the last telemetry event needs to be put into the actual state there to be able to be retrieved. So here we're going to get our message in with the latitude, longitude, and timestamp. That will go in, and if, as I mentioned, the actors will be created, or it will go to an existing actor if it's telemetry from the same run, and the output will have the speed, the total distance, the average speed, and the maximum speed. So this is how I've actually built the scenario. The files that I'm triggering this with is the GPX files, which is an XML based file that I've saved out from the sports tracker application. The telemetry simulator is a console application, and what it's doing is it's basically loading up the GPX files. Now, when I show this in real time, I'm going to actually show the actual data in real time, but what I'm going to do is take about 50 runs that I've done, 50 workouts, and have them all start at the exact same time point. So they will start when I start the demo. But for each of those 50 exercises, 50 sort of streams of telemetry data, I'm going to be sending in the telemetry real time. So it basically sends a message, and if it's 2 seconds, it will wait 2 seconds and send the message, wait a second, send the next message. So we'll get 50 exercises coming in real time, going into the actual system. The console application is sending the messages onto a service bus topic. And they're going to be then dequeued and processed by Service Fabric, and they're going to be actually sent to the actual actors themselves. So for each instance of the GPX file, which contains one workout, we're going to generate a single sports actor to handle the telemetry for that. So those guys are going to be created. What I'm doing then to actually display this on a website is sending out the information on a service bus topic. So we're basically sending out messages each time we get a bit of telemetry data. And what's going out on the service bus topic is going to be the enriched telemetry data. So that has the average speed and so on. Now I need to get those out to a website. So what I'm using there is a Signal R hub, which is dequeuing the messages from the service bus topic and sending them out through Signal R to the instances of the browser that is listening for the application. And that's what's going to give us the real-time display, where we can actually go in and we can view all of the actual telemetry data and view the actual runners are going around and so on. So what I'm going to do is just run into a quick demo of that scenario. So here is the actual application that I'm working with. We've got the telemetry simulator application. It's lying. It says cycle runs. They're not all cycle runs. Some of them is walking, but basically these are the actual GPX data that I'm working with. And you can see that it's a stream of XML, and you can see that it's quite long. This was 9,000 actual lines. So it's probably about 3,000 bits of telemetry data, 2,000 or 3,000 bits of telemetry data in those various runs there. And I'm basically using the ID as the actual file name of the actual run itself. Oh, sorry, the actual name here. This is going to be used as the actual ID for each particular run. So I've got several of these runs present that I'm going to be sending in to the actual system there. And that's going to be the telemetry data that's going in. And the telemetry simulator, as I mentioned, is very simple. It's just basically loading up these guys and sending them onto the actual service bus there. So generating a topic client and basically whizzing through. We're sleeping for however long it is between the actual telemetry events there. Generating a telemetry event here, serializing it as JSON and just firing it off onto the actual service bus there. Topic client.send, that's going to drop the message onto the service bus itself. So we've also got the actor service project present here in the solution. So when I do file new project and generate the actor, it generates several different projects. This one contains all of the stuff that you will have if you deploy it to Azure. So you've got your PowerShell deployment script here. You've got all of the publisher profiles and various bits of XML actually describe the application there. And this is the stuff that you can configure depending on the actual environment, how you want the environment to be created, the number of nodes that you're generating as well. And that's going to be the project that you're going to be deploying. We get the, let's see if I can actually zoom in on that a bit more. We get the actual actor class itself. This one contains the actual sports actor, and we get the interfaces which has the actual interface to that particular actor there. And then I've added some entities as well for the actual doing the coordinates and the actual processing of the telemetry events and so on. So if you start off looking at the interface there, I think I can zoom out now. This is the actual interface. Very simple. I'm just processing a telemetry event and sending in that telemetry event there, which is the actual class I'm working with. And then the actual sports actor implementation itself, which is this thing here. So you can see that I'm defining this as persistence. It's deriving from actor. It's implementing sports actor there. I've got my topic client present in here. And what we're doing is basically when we... Oh, yeah. It's the initialization, which is when we actually activate this. So when I activate the actor, when a new instance is created, we're going to set the total distance to zero. I'm also going to set that the last event has the time of the last event has a date time minval, and the last actual coordinate that we're dealing with is going to be just a new coordinate there. When we receive a telemetry event, what we need to do is basically do the actual comparison, figure out the various distance and so on. So we get our new telemetry data. We're saying if the last coordinate latitude is greater than zero, if we do actually have a proper telemetry reading before, we calculate all of the differences and basically figure out all of the total speeds calculations. And then I'm basically sending a new actor message out specifying that the actual total distance. I'm actually doing tracking that, and I'm basically sending out a message here with the actual new telemetry event. And what I'm doing in this new telemetry event is telemetry enrichment. I'm setting the total distance, the average speed, and so on. So we get enriched telemetry data coming out of there. The actual mapping project here, we've got a SignalR hub, which is sitting in here, and this is just basically sort of regular standard SignalR project to be able to actually send and blast out those actual events out to the listening application. So I'm going to basically start this application first. This one's going to fire up in Google Chrome. And I'm using the actual Google Maps API to actually have the mapping background. And I've got all kinds of JavaScript. I'm not a real JavaScript expert, but I managed to hack this together. So it will actually display the actual telemetry data on this map, actually moving in real time using the markers. So I need to start this application here. So what I'm going to do is click on start, and this is going to go through the actual deployment cycle. I mentioned it can take a couple of minutes to create the cluster, but my cluster is already created, so hopefully it should only take about 30 seconds for the actual application to spin up. So here is the actual local fabric cluster manager. If I go in and do manage local cluster, we'll hopefully see that I've got one node. I brought it down to one node just so it's a bit quicker when I actually run in the demos. It was a bit of an overkill running five nodes for this. And I've got one application that does appear to be healthy. I can go in and see the cluster map, you know, see details about the actual deployment and so on like that. And so that's basically showing me that the application is up and running there. And what I should be able to do now is to actually fire off the telemetry data. So this is the actual telemetry console. It's saying press enter to start. So let's go to the actual mapping application, bring up this guy and fire in the actual telemetry data. So what this is going to do is to start actually taking that telemetry data and dropping in the actual data there from the workouts. Now the workouts, if you remember, were basically did not contain any sort of a information about the speed. It was just purely where I am at a particular point in time. And you can see that these actual markers on the map do actually contain the actual speed of the actual actor that's running. So this is me picking up my kids from Dargis. This is where it tends to go really, really slowly. This is typically me cycling with a six-year-old on a bike and a two-year-old in a baby seat. So this is not going to be very fast. But it's basically, you know where I live now, but you know where I park my bike at least. But this is basically where I head off, and you can see here I'm going up this road here at sort of 19 kilometres an hour. That seems quite fast. Maybe that was when I was on my own there, but typically around sort of 12 kilometres an hour, 1 kilometre, 3.7 kilometres an hour. That's typically probably how fast my daughter cycles there. And this one here, this is when I cheated. At the Cloudburst conference, I was delivering this session. So my whole thing about this session was I actually got the session time put at about 10 or 11 in the morning because I was going to cycle to the Microsoft office, which is about sort of 20 kilometres, and then I was going to do the demo, and I was going to turn up with sort of my bike helmet and all this cycling kit and say, this is where I was actually cycling this morning, and this is my telemetry run that I did this morning. Unfortunately, it was pouring with rain when I got up that morning, so I thought, I'm not going to cycle. I'll take a taxi instead. So this is the taxi stop at the traffic lights, but that's also why it's saying like 59 kilometers an hour. I don't actually cycle at that speed, but when the lights go green, I mentioned in real time, we'll see this one accelerating. Slight bug, it should say 0 kilometers an hour, but I think it stops sending telemetry data when if you're actually not moving, so that's why it's showing the previous speed there. I'll just leave this running and we can jump back to this a bit later on. As I was mentioned, you know, if you're working on a project where you want to track telemetry data from vehicles, or if you want, you've got, you know, vehicles going around or runners, or you've got some kind of event, this is going to be cool. It's very, very scalable. It's a great way of being able to provide this map with, you know, the real-time taxis. This would be something that, you know, a taxi office would love to have on a big screen, showing sort of where all their cars are in real time and things like that. So what I'm planning on doing next, that was kind of the first thing that I built with the actor model. Second thing that I'm going to be planning with the actor model is related to the Global Azure Bootcamp. Has anybody attended the Global Azure Bootcamp in the past couple of years? So did you play the racing game, or were you involved with the racing game? So this is something that I did originally for my Plural Site Storage course. I wanted a demo that I could use in video that would come across well to the people who are learning and also would be relevant to storage. So I downloaded a sample game, which is XNA Racer. It's on an obsolete XNA game development platform that Microsoft had had a number of years ago. And I basically took that simple sort of a 3D car racing game and I integrated it with Azure. So the ghost cars were stored in Azure Blob Storage, the telemetry data went through the queues, and I was using table storage to store all the high score data and telemetry data for all of the laps. And it was just a pilot project that I used to, good scenario to use for demos to show people, you know, cool stuff that you can do with Microsoft Azure, but also the way that you can use table storage in a good way and the way that you can use blob storage in a good way. And this is a screenshot. You can see is IIOABN. Who's that? Somebody from Finland. Oh, no, I am from Finland. Is that you? Awesome. Yeah. Yeah, this Rui Silva guy was beating us, and we had this Finn the Rast, the guy from, he was actually sick on the day of the Global Azure Bootcamp, and he spent the entire day just at home, sick with a cold, playing this game, trying to get the high score. But this is basically, you know, it's a great community thing to have people around the world doing this and getting the actual data out there. And this is basically what the architecture looked like last year. We've got the blob storage, we've got table storage, we're using service bus, we're using worker role stream analytics and so on, and we've got a website for the presentation. And this is basically how the lap data and scoring works. When I was actually running this, this is funny, this was my actual alarm clock that I had, because this thing was going to start in Australia and then sort of roll over to the different locations around the world. So basically, I had this running. I went and slept in the living room, and I had my laptop running. And basically, this was the on message. So when somebody completed a lap, a message will get published to a topic. I had a subscription here. And I'm probably the only developer in the room who still uses console.beep. But this thing beeped. It started beeping about 3 o'clock in the morning when I think Malaysia had gotten in there and started playing the game. So I could just wake up and go in and see that everything was working correctly, and it was, so I could go back to sleep again. But yeah, it's just fun to see people around the world going in and competing, and yeah, I was just, you know, watching the Twitter feeds and seeing all of these photos coming in, you know, people around the world doing different things. And there was, you know, some competition there, but also some cooperation in that, you know, we were all doing the same thing, we were all learning about Azure, and there was hands-on labs that you could use to be able to actually, you know, gain an understanding into that. So this is what I'm planning to do. I'm planning to scale this demo that I've got and scale it up a bit. So what we're going to have is a gateway service. We're going to have the people playing the game. This is going to be going into Event Hub. Then they're going to have the player actors and the lap actors, and hopefully do the same kind of thing where you can have a real-time telemetry tracker using Signal R, so you can actually see the people with the country's flags going around in real time as they're playing the game. I don't know if I'll get it built yet, but it's going to be something fun to aim at. So mark on your diaries, April the 22nd, 2017. Scott Guthrie insists that we do that because it's going to be the Global Azure Bootcamp. We're doing it again, and this is where it's going to be in Helsinki, this actual location. If you want to learn a bit more about the actor model, a couple of videos I recommend. First one is this Hewitt, Mayer, and another guy talking about everything you wanted to know about the actor model that were afraid to ask. This is interesting. It does, the first part is good, the second part goes into theory. I have a friend at work who's doing a lot of stuff with ACCA, and he was basically saying, oh, I know about it. You know, he's a real expert on the ACCA model. He watched this video and he said, I was more confused about the ACCA model than I was before I watched the video. But it's interesting. It's a real lot of theory on how the ACCA model was developed. And then also, Mark Fussell is the guy at Microsoft who spent 8 years working on this technology, the Service Fabric technology. So this is a slightly shorter of his video on Azure Friday, when he's basically talking about the Service Fabric actor model and, you know, giving a quite high-level presentation of how that stuff works. Definitely check this stuff out if you're interested in that. Thank you very much for listening. My name's Alan Smith, and I'll be around for questions if you've got any questions or comments on the actor model. Thank you very much.